If you haven't been to Hong Kong, you've got to go. And one of the things you're going to do is to stop at the prepared meat shop, where you can buy barbecued pork all ready to go, or baby pigs. Did you see the roast pigs? I'll show you that one later on. It's a suckling pig. And of course, a lop chong, wonderful sausages. Now watch this. In ancient Rome, I'm going to show you zamponi, which is a stuffed pig foot. I found it in China. How is it that the Chinese and the Romans both enjoy stuffed pig's feet? I can't answer that. Now, on the top of the Lee Gardens Hotel, at the Rainbow Banquet Hall, the chef is cooking a suckling pig for us. This was one of the most dramatic moments of my culinary history, because I didn't know how this was done. Now notice, he's using charcoal fire, none of that gas fire for him. He claims it doesn't give good flavor. The pig is, I think it's blanched first, and then it's seasoned a bit, and then stretched out on a rack and roasted over the fire by hand. And then the chef brings the pig into the dining room. And this is my friend Kendall Oi. He's a banker in Hong Kong. He's a wonderful man. And the skin of the pig is sliced off. Oh, this is Brenda Poon. She's with the Hong Kong Travel Authority. Wonderful woman. She took us everywhere in Hong Kong. Fine person. Now, back to the sermon. The skin is removed from the pig. The fat is taken off of it. And the skin is cut up. And that's what you eat. The rest of the pig goes back to the kitchen. You see how he cuts this very carefully? It's just the skin. He puts it back on the pig. Then the skin is put into a little pancake. Very much like, this is Ken's wife, Grace. She's so beautiful. It is put into a little pancake affair, very much like Peking duck. And it is just heaven. Very good, she said. That's as critical as she's going to get. She's a fine cook. Now, in Athens, you see things a little bit differently. Pork has been very, very popular in Greece for thousands of years. I'm having an argument with this man. He wins. I could get it out of him for the price I wanted. In any case, in ancient Greece, pigs were fed on acorns and chestnuts, and they were wonderful. Now, in Rome, you'll not find as much fresh pork as you will find preserved pork. The best hams in the world come from Rome. Here's zamponi, the stuffed pig's foot. You see it hanging there all dried and ready? And these are the wonderful hams from Rome. Oh, I can't. If you've never tasted one of those, if you've never tasted a beautiful pancetta, that's bacon. The ham is very different. This is very, very beautiful, and it's dried and wonderful. It's none of that squishy stuff that we have. Here is a pork shop. He sells nothing but pork, and he's just off a wonderful street in Rome called Via Matero. It's a wonderful spot. Now watch this. He's not about to put this in a plastic sack for you and then wrap it up and stick it in a supermarket cabinet. He does everything per order, by hand. Yes, he's expensive. I admit that. But all good things are expensive. And the pork in this city is just terrific. It's just wonderful. Finally, when you have dinner in a restaurant that is typical of the region of Bologna, you can order stuffed pig's foot or zamponi. I'm going to make one of these for you one of these days. This was came with a boiled dinner. Look at that. All pork. It's stuffed with a sausage very much like cotechino. He gave me the best part. Look at this. It's a pig's foot. Just the skin. The bone in the center is removed, and this is a great holiday delicacy. And the foot itself is stuffed and then boiled and served. It's absolutely incredible. It's got to be one of my favorite pork dishes in the whole world. Did you remember the picture we had of Michela eating there with me, the gorgeous lady that was there, cooked a zamponi for me when I first went to Rome? I'll never be the same. All right, let's start cooking. First of all, we have to start with China, because the Chinese really love pork more than anybody. So I'm going to prepare for you crispy roast side pork, and we'll just cook until we have to quit today, which is what we always do. First thing you want to do with a piece of side pork, this is fresh bacon, you see. Try and find a nice lean piece, but the skin is still on it. We want that. You want to puncture the skin. And I'm using, look at this, I'm using an ice pick, which has several prongs on it. You can make a little board with some nails in it and do that. Or I can use just a plain old ice pick, you see. But what you want to do is to poke a lot of holes in this. And then you want to put about a teaspoon of salt on it. About a half on each side, you see. We're going to draw out some of the moisture. Rub it in. Ah, that's enough. Rub it in, and then I'll show you the marinade. This is so wonderful. If you like barbecued pork, well, I think this is better. It's called lichen. Lichen in the market, in the Chinese market. Wonderful thing. Now, we'll make a marinade of 1 tablespoon of mainseed. You remember when we talked about condiments, mainseed is sometimes called soybean jam or soybean condiment. It's wonderful stuff. And a tablespoon of dark soy sauce. Not that light one, but the dark one. See how black the color is? It's primarily sugar that colors it that, or molasses. A little bit of salt, about 1/4 teaspoon. We don't need much salt because there's a lot of salt in soy sauce. So you don't need that. And about 1 teaspoon of sugar. A little sugar, not to make it sweet, but to just enhance the flavors. That'll do it for you. And some ginger. I want about 1 teaspoon of ginger. And I'm going to use my little bitty washboard here so you can just grate that. Fresh ginger root. Buy that in almost any American supermarket in our time. All right, mix that all up. I'll give you the recipe again. Main seed, dark soy, salt, sugar, the ginger, and finally, a bit of garlic. And let me show you what I'm going to do. I have given up crushing garlic each time, and I'm now chopping garlic about 40 cloves at a time and putting it in a jar and sticking it in the refrigerator with a little bit of oil on it. So we want 1 clove of garlic, and it's all chopped up and ready, you see? I chopped it in my food processor. You understand what I'm saying? Works great. Works great. No, don't throw away your garlic press. You need that too. Now, the side pork or fresh bacon goes into the sauce and marinate this for, oh, a good couple of hours. There we are. You can get by with an hour, I suppose. And then this will go on a rack. And you can put it on any sort of oven rack. I'll show you what I've done with mine. Where did I put it? You want to broil it with the skin side up. Bake it first, then broil it. Let's get this straight. Bake it first with the skin side up. Let me get one out here and show it to you. In about I have so many pork dishes for you. So good. Ouch, he shrunk a little bit, of course. Put him on a rack and broil him with the skin side up at about 1.5 hours. Bake him 1.5 hours at 350. Now, the reason I'm confusing myself and you too is because after you bake him for 1.5 hours, 350 degrees, turn on the broiler. So you put him in the middle rack of the oven, bake him for 1.5 hours, and then you turn on the broiler and broil the skin until it is crunchy. See that? And this dish is highly prized in China. Highly prized because it's very, very rich and very delicious. I'll cut it a bit for you and show you what I mean. It's very elegant. Very elegant indeed. Let's see here what we have. It's so crunchy. You've got to start with the meat side down and cut it up that way. There. Let me put that on the platter. You see how rich it is? Oh, this is terribly rich and very beautiful. You can cook this with other dishes, too. I like it chowed with oysters or with bean curd, or you can put it in a sand pot and make a wonderful dish that way. All right, that's one for you. One pork dish from China. There are many, many more. The next one is barbecued pork, and I'm doing that only because everybody thinks that barbecued pork's the best thing in China, but it's just not, and it's not typical of a good Hong Kong eating. You don't order that at a dinner, but I'll show you what I've done. I have a batch of it here, and I'm just going to give you the recipe loosely. What I want to show you is the process of cooking, because that's more important than your seasonings. I have marinated the pork, and let me show you what kind of a piece I've used. Buy pork butt, you see, that's not completely lean, because it must have a little fat in it, or the meat's going to be dry, and that's not what you want. Now, cut the meat up into strips, about, 1.5 inches square or so, like this, you see, and then marinate the meat in a mixture of soy sauce, chicken broth. This is all in our cookbook on Three Ancient Cuisines, so I'm not going to do the whole thing for you. I just want you to see it. But it's chicken broth, soy, mainseed, wine or sherry, a bit of honey. That's what gives it the color. Garlic, of course, and some salt. And the thing you have to hear about is hosin, hosin sauce. Hosin sauce is a bean product with a bit of soy and sugar in it, and it's sometimes called a barbecue sauce in China. And it's just wonderful. That'll give it the flavor. But the other thing is the mainseed, the fermented bean, which is left over from the process of making soy sauce. This is what makes the difference between good barbecue pork and plain old stuff you buy in a Chinese deli down the street. It's not worth it. This is the kind you want. Roast this in a rack. So I have a rack so that heat can get under as well. I have two racks here. You see that? I have two racks. This one has water underneath it so that I won't have any smoke in the oven. That's as close as you can come to a Chinese oven in your own kitchen. And roast it at about 350 degrees for, about 45 minutes. And then turn the heat up to 450 degrees and let it sit for about 15 minutes in the oven. And then you'll get that crunchy coating that, that I absolutely love. It's really just burned sugar. But why not? Let me put a bit on a plate here and we'll go on. Oh, boy, I can't even find a spot to put everything. I have piggies all over the place. Can you imagine 400 million pigs in the world? Why not? There. This is not that dry stuff you see in a restaurant, you see, because they cook theirs way ahead of time, and then they put it in the refrigerator and let it dry, and then they slice it up for you. It's just, I think it's disgusting stuff. I never order it in an American restaurant, unless, of course, it's someone that I know is going to do a good job for me. But this is great. This is just wonderful stuff. And you can make a batch of that, keep it in your refrigerator, and then cook it with other dishes. Recook it, so to speak. All right? Now, I can show you spare ribs, too, but that's, again, basically the same sort of sauce, but add a little bit of Tabasco to your spare rib sauce, and you'll have something really wonderful. A little bit of sesame oil and some five spice wouldn't hurt. And I have spare ribs all over the place, too. These are just beautiful. I baked them at 400 degrees. That sounds a little high for you, but 400 degrees is just about right for about 35 or 40 minutes. And then I stuck them under the broiler for just a moment because I wanted to put a glaze on them. And that's how you get the glaze, is a little bit of, there, a little bit of last-minute broiling. Then you cut these up and serve them. Oh, Lord, that's heavy. Cut these up and serve them to your guests. Don't cut them up and cook them separately. You understand what I'm saying? That means you're going to have a very dry product. You don't want that. We're not only running out of space on the counter, we're running out of space in the sink. Because pork is the most versatile meat ever. And please don't think that that if you're going to cut down on cholesterol that you have to avoid pork. It's true that you can have spare ribs, perhaps. But pork generally has very wide pieces of fat in it. It's not grainy fat like you would find in a good piece of prime beef. So you can trim the fat very carefully and very easily and enjoy yourself. It's not high in cholesterol. Not high at all if you trim the fat. Did you hear me? Now don't you go to your doctor and say, Jeff Smith said you could have all the pork sausage in the world. That's full of fat. You have to cut back on that. All right, let's go on. I want to show you a dish that I learned from a wonderful woman by the name of Annie Gilo. Annie taught me something. Annie was from Taiwan. This dish you can cook overnight. Did you get that? Let me give you the recipe. First of all, this is a fancy casserole from China. It's very cheap, but it's called a sandpot. Sandpot. You can use any kind of casserole you want. Into that, I'm going to put three green onions. One, two, three. Just throw them in the pot. Cut them up into big pieces here. Three green onions. About a teaspoon of ginger, fresh ginger. We're going to make a simmered pot roast. Pork roast, so we don't have to do a thing to it. Just wonderful stuff. And we're going to add a couple of star anise. This is a wonderful condiment, and it is a star. So right away, the one that comes out doesn't look like a star. It looks like somebody stepped on it. Well, those two look like stars, you see. I don't buy very good quality because they're third the price of the expensive ones, so that you see if they had all of their stars, and then you'd pay three times as much money. But we just want a couple of star anise flowers. Because the Chinese like to decorate with star anise. That's why it's more expensive. You don't need that. Two tablespoons of mengsi or soybean condiment. That's plenty. And let's see, two tablespoons of light soy sauce. Yes, I have to check my recipes. I wish that I could remember two tablespoons there of light soy sauce. The complexity of Chinese cooking. It's a matter of well-balanced condiments. And you really have to pay attention to what you're doing. Two teaspoons of brown sugar to sweeten it a bit. Brown sugar, a half cup of wine. Now, I'm using Chinese rice wine. You can use dry sherry, of course. Oh, this is a good dish. It's just one of my favorites ever. I love it. I keep telling you that all the time. You must wonder about me, don't you, huh? How many favorites can you have? Well, When my second son was born, Jason, he nearly died. I've told you that story, I think. And I stopped and hugged him, and I said, little man, I don't think I can ever love you as much as I love your brother. His brother was already 18 months old. You know the problem I'm talking about? Of course, it was a stupid thing to have to think about, because your loves go on and on and on. So now I've got two of them, and I love them both. You don't have to worry about that anymore. So if I keep saying to you, this is my favorite dish in the whole world, trust me, it's the truth. All right, I want a whole two or three cloves of garlic chopped up, and now a little bit of white pepper. There we go. Oh, what, half a teaspoon? And about 2 cups of water, just water right out of the tap. This will make its own broth. There we go. And then we're going to put the pork roast in here. Mix all of this up. You see? Isn't this fun? It's a fabulous dish. Stir all of this up, and then add the pork roast. Just set the old pork roast, about 2.5 pounds of pork butt, right in the pot. And I told you, you can use a plain casserole if you like. Put him in there, and put him in a 275-degree oven. You heard me? 275 is what you want. Turn him over once or twice during the baking process and bake him anywhere between 5 hours and 8 hours. That is to say, you can make this late at night before you go to bed and get up in the morning to the most heavenly smell, 275, no more, in the oven. Get up the most heavenly smell. You can't believe it. It's so wonderful. I have one all prepared for you. Too hot to handle? Well, not quite. Are you ready? This is wonderful odor, wonderful flavor, fabulous dish. There. I'm going to turn that over before I put it out for you. I want you to see how tender it is. You see, it'll just fall apart right now. You see that? Look at it. Oh, it's good. And you just rip this up and serve it. You don't try and cut it. That's a waste of time. You don't try and cut it at all. You just tear it up and put it on the table for your guests. There. All right, I want one more Chinese meatball dish to show you. Actually, I have several. I have three, but there are wonderful things you can do with Chinese meatballs. Basic pork ground up with basic seasoning of soy, sherry, and ginger, that sort of thing. I have some others in the book that will be kind of fun for you, but here's what I want you to do. Think about this sort of thing. Let's see. Here it is. This one is great fun, and I'm not quite sure what we're going to call it. Good Chinese meatballs, you see? And I'm going to roll them in a noodle. And this noodle is called a siphon. Remember, we've talked about this? And I've chopped it up into short pieces so that it's going to look like this little noodle has lamb's wool on it. Or sometimes they're called bird's nest noodles. I'll do a couple of these and throw them in the fat. It'll take just a minute before you... you'll see what'll happen. Let's do that now. Okay. Now, this is 360 degrees, and they'll take just a moment to cook. Now you have to get them out. Do a whole batch, about 4 seconds, take them out and drain them, and then, later on, turn your fat down to 325 and cook them until they're finished. And let me show you what you have. You can name this dish anything you want, for heaven's sakes, but what happens is they wind up looking like meatballs with lamb's wool on them, or lamb's wool or bird's nest. I know what my boys would call this. You know what they would call this? They would call this dish meatballs with a disease. Look at them. But they're very beautiful. You can also roll the meatballs in soaked sticky sweet rice. That's a wonderful pearl rice that's been, that's very high in gluten. And soak them. Soak the rice first and then roll the meatball in it. Put it on a little lettuce square, you see? Little square of lettuce. This goes in your steamer. And then steam these for about 45 minutes. And let me show you what you have. Oh, this one's fun. I'm using an electric wok today. I've told you never to buy one. Because I don't think any of them get hot enough. But this one, this is a Maxim. Let me shut it off here. There it's off. And it does get hot enough just for steaming. I don't chow in it. But here you have what are called pearl meatballs. See how beautiful they are? And the sticky sweet rice takes on a glisten very much like a pearl. So you have pearl meatballs. Now, let's go to Athens, and I have a pot here. This is so simple that all I'm going to tell you is that what you do is to, let me find a pot fork here. Here we go. Is to brown some pork roast, boneless pork roast, and then cook it with a bit of broth and wine a little bit of salt and pepper, and then during the last half hour before it's really tender, you add a whole bunch of chopped celery leaves. And I want lots of leaves because it's the celery that gives this dish the incredible flavor. Very, very simple cooking. The Greeks don't do a lot with dramatic flavorings, and I don't suppose they should, but it's a wonderful dish. Celery and pork. We had this at Taverna Sigalas at Monstraki Square in Athens. You've got to try it. Finally, in Rome, oh, do they go to a lot of work. Pork is considered a holiday dish in Rome, and look at this one. They will tell us a big plate for this. Ah, here we are. The pork roast is rolled up inside of side pork, you see, fresh bacon. And then I have rosemary and olive oil, salt and pepper in mine, nothing more. And then you bake this until the skin is very, very crunchy. And when you slice it, the drama that occurs is just terrific. Let me show you here. Get the right spot for us. It's just wonderful. Look at that. You see how beautiful it is? Hear that crunchiness? That's what you want. That crunchiness is what does it. Let me put this on a serving platter now. There. This is so... Actually, I have a friend with me today who's sitting in the corner glaring at me in the corner of my kitchen. He's behind the stove. Stay there. His name is Roberto Balzoni from Rome. And Roberto said, no, that's not just Roman. It came from Bologna, which is near Modena, which is where he was born. He and Pavarotti, you see. Wonderful foods in Italy where pork is celebrated properly. Don't just think of pork sausage in our culture. Think of the fact that pork has an incredible history and wonderful possibilities. You can go on and on and on with pork. I've tried to go on and on and on today, so let's review. First of all, I made for you a crispy side pork from China. I gave you the recipe on that one. That's easy to do. Barbecued pork is simple, providing you remember you have to have heat all the way around. Spare ribs are basically the same marinade, but with a shot of Tabasco and a little sesame oil. You must try Annie Gilo, that's her name, Annie Gilo's pot roast. This is wonderful from Taiwan. Fuzzy meatballs or meatballs with lamb's wool, pearl meatballs, a wonderful pork roast, pork roll really, from Rome, and finally, from Athens, pork cooked with celery. There it is. Now, how do we thank the pig? Well, first of all, you realize that you and I have to stop maligning the pig. It's not fair to say if someone, he eats like a pig and try and be insulting, or to say he's dirty as a pig. Pigs are clean if you give them a chance. That's the truth. Well, enough with pigs. This is the Frugal Gourmet. Until I see you again, I bid you peace. Oink, oink.
The Frugal Gourmet was made possible by a grant from LK Manufacturing Company. LK brings out the beauty of America's kitchens by offering a full line of kitchen sinks, faucets, and accessories, including the Euro-style Calais faucet. Just say LK, the state of the art in the cooking arts. Additional funding provided by this and other public television stations. Local broadcast of this program is made possible in part by Red Star Yeast, an American tradition in baking for more than 100 years.